there. So right now we have a grant where we go into the schools and we do nutrition education, we do tobacco cessation. So that's my main function at the health department. We also do some community assessments that I'm part of too, and community coalitions. So that's my main job at the health department. Today I'm going to talk to you about diabetes awareness, some of the signs and symptoms of diabetes, and also adult vaccinations. I know that's kind of been in the news lately, so we'll talk about that as well. But if you have any questions as we go, feel free to stop me. And again, I'm not a nurse, so I won't give you medical advice, but I'll tell you what I do know. So.
And she can stand up.
Yes, and I have a couple of guests too. All right, so first, just a little bit about the health department. I know you had somebody here from the health department before, but we're just asked at the beginning of every presentation to give you a little bit of information about what we do at the health department. So, like I mentioned, we assess the needs of the community, and then we work with partners to address those needs. Right now, we're working on obesity, access to health care, which is, you know, making sure we have enough doctors and people have insurance coverage, things like that. And then our third focus area is on behavioral health or mental health. So those are the three areas we're focusing on now. We have an environmental health department, which goes out and does inspections. If you're building a new house, they do food inspections, wells, pools, things like that. So those are our sanitarians. We do birth and death certificates, maybe you've been there for one of those. We investigate disease outbreaks, so there's a list of reportable diseases, things like herpes, or I can't think of them off my head, the hepatitis, yeah. So there's a list. If your doctor gets a case, they have to report it to the health department, then we put it into our database so we can kind of track diseases and see if there are outbreaks. It could be waterborne, foodborne, environmental, and with Zika, we were talking about that a little bit, that will be another thing to kind of keep our eye on as far as disease outbreaks go. And then we also have a personal health service division. We do immunizations. We have Help Me Grow program, which sees new moms and helps them with the first 3 years. We have home health and hospice, which was here to speak to you last time, or a few months ago. And then we have a reproductive health and wellness clinic as well. So that's just an overview of the health department. So diabetes, probably all know what it is, but just to kind of give you a little bit of an overview, it's an abnormal blood glucose or sugar level. So again, that's usually above normal. There is a condition where your blood sugar is too low, but diabetes would mean your blood sugar is too high. And the only way you can really tell that for sure is through a blood test. But we'll get into some of the other signs and symptoms that you want to look out for in a few minutes. So basically, it's your pancreas. That's the organ that fails to make the right amount of insulin, which is a hormone that controls the sugar in your blood. And diabetes is a serious disease. I know some people may be diagnosed and not take it real seriously, but it is serious. It's the seventh leading cause of death in the United States. So a lot of people realize that, but there's a lot of resources and support for people out there who are diagnosed. So hopefully if you ever know anybody who is diagnosed with you, tell why you take it seriously. Some of the higher complications are blindness. Maybe you've heard of somebody with diabetes going blind or having vision problems, kidney failure, heart disease, stroke, and then a foot or toe. Yeah.
How often does the problem exist that the pancreas is doing what it's supposed to do, but the insulin is not getting to the liver or to the destination where it can work?
I don't know the percentage or the rate of that, but that is certainly one way the insulin is ineffective. So it's not necessarily that your pancreas isn't making enough insulin, but like you said, it may be that it's not going to the right place or being processed properly by your body. But I don't know the rate on that.
But it is.
Go ahead.
But it does happen.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the items you might encounter stop the insulin from getting where it should be?
I would say it's mainly genetic. You know, a lot of these things are predisposed, and they're still learning more about diabetes as well. They don't know exactly why some people get it and why some people don't. So I think they're still learning more about that piece. I'm going to go into type 1 versus type 2 in a minute, so maybe that'll give you a little bit more information on kind of the rates and where people fall.
Here's a question. I'm just theory, guessing, whatever. Do you think people that have sugar have a bigger tendency to have more plaques along the body?
Well, having an increased sugar level a lot of times is associated with being overweight or obese, so that can certainly lead to more plaque as well. Unfortunately, a lot of times the chronic conditions like obesity, heart disease, diabetes kind of go together.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So now, yeah, we'll talk a little bit more about the different types of diabetes. Type 1. Your body does not make enough insulin. So this is something that you would most likely be diagnosed with in your youth. It's something that typically you're born with. You can see there, it can develop at any age, but typically it's in the youth. In each year, there are about 18,000 youth diagnosed with it. And if you look at both type 1 and type 2, type 1 only makes up about 5% of all of the cases. So the most predominant one is definitely type 2, but I wanted to mention type 1 because it's out there as well. So type 2, your body cannot use insulin properly. It can develop at any age, and it, in most cases, can be prevented. We have a handout that will kind of look at the risk factors and how to prevent, the best ways to prevent type 2 diabetes. Currently, if we keep going at the rates we're going with obesity and the health choices that Americans are making in general, 1 out of 3 people will develop diabetes in their lifetime. So I was kind of surprised by that statistic. That's quite a lot. So that's type 1 and type 2. There's also a condition called prediabetes, which means that your blood glucose or your blood sugar levels are elevated, but not to the point where you would be diagnosed as a type 2 diabetic. So there's quite a few people who would fall into that category with the elevated but not high enough to be classified as a diabetic. And I think I have my number here. Okay, so with prediabetes, 15 to 30% of those individuals will develop type 2 within 5 years. So if you are diagnosed with prediabetes, that's not necessarily, meaning that in a few more years you'll get type 2 diabetes. Again, only 15 to 30% of individuals with prediabetes develop type 2. So there are things you can do once, if you get that prediabetes diagnosis, to prevent it from escalating. And then the last one I just put on the gestational diabetes. That one is only affects pregnant women. Maybe you've heard of somebody having gestational diabetes. It would just be for the duration of the pregnancy, but it is, again, a serious disease. It can have implications on the mom and the baby. So,
is that check for that in pregnant women on a regular basis, or do they have to ask for it? Or?
It's routine now, yeah. I think about the beginning of the third trimester, that's a standard screening.
I really crave candy bars. I was crazy the first time. Nobody said nothing.
Yeah. One of the symptoms of a gestational diabetes is a large baby. So a lot of times those moms deliver earlier or they have a real large baby. That's just one of the signs for that one. Okay. So who is at risk? Again, I have a handout here for you. I'm going to hand it out for you. It's a diabetes risk test. So if you want to look it over, you basically score for yourself. You don't have to do it right now, but just to give you an idea of the different factors. No, okay, can you pass those down for me? Thank you. That influence your risk for diabetes. So first is age. Just like most things. Age, if you're less than 40, you know, your risks are pretty low. 40 to 49 years, you get 1 point. 50 to 59, 2 points. 60-year-old, you get 3 points. So as your age increases, you're at a greater risk for diabetes. Again, your risk is higher if you're a male versus a female. Like we just talked about gestational diabetes, if you were diagnosed with that condition while you were pregnant, that does increase your risk for type 2 diabetes as well. If you have a close relative with diabetes, like I mentioned, it is a genetic condition. So a mother, father, sister, or brother with diabetes would increase your risk. A condition of high blood pressure also increases your risk for diabetes. Again, those chronic conditions go hand in hand a lot of times. And physical activity, that's one of the best ways to prevent type 2 diabetes, is to be physically active. So if you're not, that is a risk factor. And then number 7 here is your weight status. Again, obesity and overweight individuals do have a higher risk of getting type 2 or developing type 2 diabetes. So you can figure out your score there. If you score 5 or higher, it certainly doesn't mean that you have diabetes. It's just something that you might want to discuss with your doctor. If you're going in for your annual checkup, they typically do blood work anyway, so that would be something to have a conversation with them about. All right, and then on here it also mentions that in certain races, diabetes is more common. That would be African Americans, Hispanics, American Indians, and Asian Americans have a higher risk factor as well. So there's that information for you. You can see I have one more infographic here, just to kind of give you the overall count. 29.1 million people in the United States have diabetes. That's 1 out of every 11. So it is really a pretty common condition. 1 out of every 4 of those who have diabetes don't know that they have it. So something that, again, you'd want to talk to your doctor about. Hopefully with more people getting coverage, that number will go down, but we don't know. And then pre-diabetes, like I mentioned, 86 million. So that is even more prevalent than diabetes itself. But 9 out of 10 of those individuals don't know they have it. So that one is a lot more undiagnosed. So here are the symptoms of diabetes. Again, these are common symptoms. Not everyone will have all of these symptoms. Some people, their symptoms may be so mild that they don't even know they're having them. So first would be frequent urination, excessive thirst, unexplained weight loss, extreme hunger even after you've eaten, sudden vision changes or blurry vision, tingling or numbness in hands or feet, feeling very tired much of the time, very dry skin, sores that are slow to heal, and more infections than usual. So I know a lot of these overlap with other conditions, but I think the first two are probably the most telltale signs, frequent urination and excessive thirst. Those are good ones. I know it's summer now, but as we go throughout the year, keep those in mind if you see that a lot. Now, treatment and care. So if you are diagnosed with diabetes, like I mentioned, there are a lot of resources available. It's certainly much wiser to care for your diabetes and to manage it than to ignore it and let the conditions compound. So the key recommendations for anyone diagnosed with diabetes are going to be eat healthy and be physically active. Eating healthy, you've probably heard when you get diabetes, there's certain things you can and can't eat. That's not really the thinking. flash starches and carbohydrates, so things like that you want to keep an eye on, but there's really nothing totally
What's
off.
What's an explanation for a carbohydrate?
Okay, so a carbohydrate would be, I think of like the grain categories, so bread, pasta, cereal, things like that. But then
you put your mouth.
Well, yeah, there are carbohydrates in everything, you're right. Yeah, I mean, fruits and vegetables have carbohydrates as well, but some are more than others. So, like a starchy vegetable, like a potato versus spinach. The potato is going to have a lot more carbohydrates than the spinach. So, it does take work to manage diabetes. I'm not trying to downplay that at all. You know, you want to meet with a dietitian. You'd want to learn, you know, what's going to work best for you as far as...
Well, my doctor out and out, she says, well, how many carbohydrates do you take in? And I said, well, what do you mean? That's everything you eat. It's just a matter of some foods have a higher carbohydrate content.
Linda, you can't put bacon grease on it.
I usually use olive
oil. But you're right. Carbohydrates are in everything, and it needs balancing. You're right, and portion. I think portion control is another big piece of that.
Well,
making sure.
Yeah. And my doctor also said, I told her, I said, I took my blood sugar. Well, my husband recommended it. I was beginning to feel shaky and a little terminal uptight. And he says, well, take your blood sugar. And it was 97. And really, that isn't considered all that low. But for me, I was used to having it at a higher level. And it did affect me. And my doctor looked at me and told me, oh, no, that wouldn't do it.
A lot of it has to do with your own personal whatever. So, because I'm pre-diabetic. And at first, my numbers were, you know, 115 or so fasting and dieting. And when your body's used to that, if I would hit the 90s, yes, I felt shaky. At this point, when I'm 85, 90 every day, I'm used to it. So if your doctor wants it lower, you have to do it gradually so you don't get that shaky feeling. And eventually, your body will get used to this. Yeah, your body adjusts.
Great advice. Yeah, I meant to mention in the morning, it can be especially difficult if you haven't eaten all night, you may be crashing, and it's the highs and lows that can make you feel that way. All right. Physical activity is another important piece. Even something as simple as walking, can have a lot of benefits. So it doesn't have to be anything real strenuous. It doesn't have to be for an hour at a time. It can be 10 minutes at a time. So, and that's true for a whole list of conditions. If you're a type 1 diabetic, that includes insulin injections. Some people have a pump that they carry with them. Some people use syringes and things like that. So it's all what they have set up with their healthcare provider. And if you're a type 2 diabetic, like you mentioned, that includes testing your blood sugar. It all depends on how frequently. Diabetes is a progressive disease, so if you're able to be pre-diabetic at the beginning and you don't need any medication, you may move into an oral medication as the disease progresses, and then eventually you may need insulin injections as a type 2 diabetic as well. But it can, like I mentioned, you can also move from a pre-diabetic and prevent yourself from going into type 2 diabetes with exercise and physical and eating healthy. So it's really, you do have some control over the disease depending on your lifestyle and your habits. So, and then the last one is just work with healthcare professionals. Again, this is something that you're going to want to see your doctor about on a regular basis. Check those numbers regularly. Work with a dietitian to make sure you're eating healthy, things like that. So that's all I have on diabetes. Do you guys have any questions? Anything else you want to share?
I saw something on the computer. It's called Reversing Diabetes. And this doctor did a video, and he talked about people that had weight loss surgery, and they no longer had diabetes. But he said it wasn't the surgery. It was the diet that went on before they had the surgery. It took care of the diabetes.
So did they stop the symptoms of diabetes before the surgery or after?
After the surgery. When he said it was a diet they were on before they had the surgery, that was the surgery that eliminated the diabetes. It was a diet they were on before they had the surgery.
Okay. Well, do you know what it was?
No, I'm not really sure. I'm going to actually take further.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't heard of that myself, but certainly I think the weight loss played a key too, but you know, maybe it was a good the diet change stuck with them and then they carried it on after the surgery as well. So
I have a new bariatric surgery that I don't know if you've heard about it or not. I read about it in the newspaper. It's like a balloon they put down in your stomach by way of your throat. You don't even have to be cut on. But there is a drawback to that. It does cause you to be nauseated on a regular basis, I imagine, until your body gets used to it.
I wonder how long that lasts, too.
I don't know. So it doesn't sound too
So then we'll move on to vaccines. All right, so why do adults need vaccines? Maybe you think you're too old to get vaccinated, you did all that as a kid, you don't need anything now. But that's really not the case. There are several instances of why you may need a vaccine. So first, you may no longer be protected. Some vaccines, like whooping cough and tetanus, they need boosters. So my tetanus, you need a booster shot every 10 years to make sure that your antibodies stay strong and help you prevent that disease. So there's one case where you may need a vaccine. Vaccines also help protect your children and grandchildren. A lot of, you might have seen an ad for the whooping cough vaccine if you're having a grandchild. Because those children can't be vaccinated at such a young age, you really have to prevent yourself from getting the disease and then spreading it to the child. So that's why they recommend new parents and grandparents get that one. Some vaccines are just for adults. The shingles vaccine, for example, they don't give that to children. So that's one you have to get as an adult. If you're doing any international travel, you may need a vaccine. If you're going to sub-Saharan Africa or tropical South America, you have to get the yellow fever. There's different vaccines depending on where you're planning to travel to.
Malaria?
Malaria, yeah. I think there might be a pill or something like that that you have to take for malaria. Yeah, that's good advice to always talk to your physician before you get any type of vaccine. That's, yeah, there are, you guys are right, there's lots of conditions that you may have chronic conditions or something like that that would prevent you from getting a certain vaccine. So they're not for everybody, but it's something that you want to talk to your doctor about.
If anybody's hesitant about this shingles vaccine, I have a friend I went to school with. She came up to visit for the alumni banquet and she had to wear something on her arm because she had shingles. And I saw pictures of it and it was awful. And it affected her nerves and even air. She can't stand the touch of air. She left to go back to Florida and I made an appointment to get a shingles shot.
I think that's a lot of times what it takes. But if you talk to just one person with shingles, all the cases I've heard have been pretty severe like that. Very painful rash. Like you said, even air can hurt it. And some people have milder cases where maybe it's just on their side, but other people can have it all the way up their neck and on their face. Typically, it is on just one side of your body, but I've heard it's very, very painful. You're right.
Why do you When you've had shingles, can you still have the vaccine? Should you have the vaccine?
Yes, they do recommend, even if you've had shingles, to get the vaccine from preventing it occurring again.
Okay.
And on that same note, even if you don't remember having the chicken pox, which is, the base for shingles, you can still get the vaccine. It's still recommended that you get the shingles vaccine, even if you don't remember having chicken pox. Yeah. And then the last one, everyone needs a flu vaccine every year, so hopefully you're all getting a flu shot every year. I just wanted to spend a couple minutes on the two, I don't want to say most common, but these are some of the ones that we get the most questions about. So for shingles, the name of the vaccine is called Zostavax. We mentioned the side effects already, so it's recommended for people over age 60, again, unless you have a special condition where you want to talk to your doctor. It's a one-time vaccine. Even if you had it, you can get it again. I'm not an insurance buff, but I do read that Medicare Part D plans cover the shingles vaccine. So we do offer that at the health department. They offer it at pharmacies. I know a lot of doctor's offices also offer vaccines. So there's the information on that one. And then a little bit of a newer one is the pneumococcal vaccine. If you don't know, pneumococcal disease can cause pneumonia. That's the most similar to the name. But it can also cause bloodstream infections or meningitis. So those are all pretty serious conditions. It is the leading cause of vaccine preventable death in America. So I didn't know that, but that's a good vaccine to get as well. It is, for most people, recommended two shots. The first is the PCV13 or Prevnar, if you've seen a commercial for that, Prevnar. And the second one is the PPSV23 or Pneumovax. And those are recommended for adults over age 65. They can't be given at the same time, so you have to give them a year apart, is the recommendation. But again, you can work with your healthcare professional on timing for those. I know you can't get one with your flu shot, so maybe if you're going in for that, you can get a pneumonia vaccine as well. And again, one is fully paid for by Medicare Part D. So.
On the pneumococcal, is that once you've had the two, is it two and done? Or is there something that you've got to,
That's a good question.
My doctor had said every 5 years.
Everybody?
But then I'm asthmatic, so I don't know if that recommendation is for everybody or just for those that. But then, since up there 65 and older, and mine wanted me to have it as soon as it became available.
That's why. Because younger people can still get the PPSV23 if they have autoimmune type condition.
Mm-hmm. No.
And actually,
are
I think they have
supposed to get the Prevnar 13 also?
I think that they just do the Pneumovax when
okay.
You
go. Because I asked my doctor and he said he didn't think I needed the Prevnar, but he wanted to make sure I got the Pneumovax.
Yeah, I'm not seeing the rates or frequency of how often you need a booster for this one, so I'm not real sure on that. But I do think that you do need boosters for that.
Maybe that's something they tell you once you have
it. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Right, tell me.
So this is my other handout for you. It's just basically kind of a summary of what we talked about with the vaccines. There's a whole list on the front page. So we talked about pneumococcal, we talked about shingles. Another one is the HPV vaccine. That's just for those under age 26. So if you have a child or grandchild there, that one is a fairly new vaccine. Measles, mumps, rubella, or MMR. That would be something to get if you didn't complete all of your childhood vaccines. Typically nowadays, that one would be covered in your standard immunization, but maybe if you didn't get all of those or you're not sure, that would be something to check on. And then chickenpox, that's a fairly new vaccine as well. I know I got the chickenpox with the disease because the vaccine wasn't available. But if you didn't get it or you didn't receive that vaccine, that might be another one to follow up on. And then something you were mentioning with the asthma on the back page here, some vaccines you may need depending on existing health conditions, lifestyle, or job. So this one gives you recommended vaccines based on, like I said, if you have asthma, if you have liver disease, if you have heart disease, if you have diabetes, there's different recommendations on when you get specific disease vaccines. So that one's there. And this is all information from the CDC, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So that's a pretty good source. That's where we get our vaccine recommendations and the information that we share with anybody who comes into the health department. So, then my last slide I already mentioned, but you don't have to get your vaccines at the health department, but we do offer them Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays, our typical vaccine days. We do accept insurance. There's also local pharmacies, like you mentioned, but if you have any special conditions, you want to check with your doctor at least first before you got those. Do you guys have any questions?
Back to diabetes.
Is
that like ever skip a generation, or is this something that can just follow your family tree from point A all the way up to?
The combinations of genes and the possibilities, and they are endless, I think. So that's certainly possible, you know, for to skip a generation. Just like you may have 50 redheads, then you have a blonde hair, then you have more redheads. You know, the combination of genes, I think, are really a lot. So not to say that you'll necessarily get it if your parents had it, but it is a strong indicator.
Or if you go in for, like, your yearly blood work, say your doctor sends you in to have these blood tests, and I have glucose, something's on there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they list the parameters, and if you're in there, but if you're in there that day, could you still be in there 6 months from now? Or could you
outside
the limits?
So glucose specifically is something that fluctuates a lot based on your diet. So it depends on when you last ate, what your last meal was, and kind of what you've eaten in that recent time period. So glucose, I think, can fluctuate certainly more. If you have an elevated glucose level, your doctor's probably going to order an A1C test. A1C tells your blood sugar levels across a much wider picture. So that will give you an idea of your sugar levels, say, over the last month, versus glucose, which would just be a much shorter window. So your glucose could certainly go up and down more, fluctuate more, versus your A1C.
So just because I might be in the good zone, necessarily mean you're in the good zone.
Same way, yeah. It's something that you're going to want to keep an eye on.
That's the same generation.
Yeah, just like blood pressure. That can fluctuate from day to day, but you just want to keep an eye on it over the time frame to make sure it's not going up. Has it been hard for you to cook that way and eat that way?
Were you eating bigger portions than you thought, or just kind of differently?
Mm-hmm. That is good, yeah. Yeah, and just about the eating in general, you know, they say half your plate should be fruits and vegetables, so.
Use your eyes instead of your feelings.
Right. So I have another couple myths of diabetes here I'll share with you guys quick. The myth, if you're overweight or obese, you will eventually develop that type 2 diabetes. That's not true. It's certainly a risk factor, but again, not necessarily the case. It's your risks that are higher. Yeah. So eating too much sugar causes diabetes. That's not the case either. Just because you eat a lot of sugar doesn't mean you'll get diabetes. There are certainly genetics in there and different things that can trigger the disease. But the American Diabetes Association does recommend that people avoid intake of sugar sweetened beverages. So that's a big source of sugar that people may not be aware of. Things like soda, fruit punch, energy drinks, sweet teas, things like that can really add a lot of sugar to your diet. So unless you have water here tonight, that's a great choice. Many people with diabetes should eat special diabetic foods. Again, that's not true. It's just paying attention to what you are eating, eating those healthy foods in the right portions. If you have diabetes, you should only eat small amounts of starchy foods like breads, pasta, and potatoes. Again, it's just key to be part of a healthy meal plan. We talked about, you know, sweets aren't off limits, it's just watching their size, having them for a special occasion, kind of so they're more of a treat rather than every single day. People with diabetes are more likely to get colds or other illnesses. That is a myth. You're no more likely to get a cold or any other illness if you have diabetes. Again, we did talk about those risk factors at the beginning, things like stroke, kidney disease, blindness. Those are associated, but just common cold and illness, your risk isn't higher with diabetes. And last one, if you have type 2 diabetes and the doctor says you need to start using insulin, it means you failed to take care of yourself properly. That's not true. Just because you have to get on insulin doesn't mean that you didn't take care of yourself. Like I said, the disease is progressive, so for some people, that's just eventually where it leads to, but it is different. The known risks of aspartame versus the known risks of obesity. Not to say that drinking regular soda causes obesity, but it can certainly contribute to it, especially if you drink a lot of soda every single day. So I would just weigh out those risks. For me, I think the risks of obesity are much greater than the known risks of aspartame, so I feel safe drinking diet soda. And really, aspartame, artificial sweeteners, are in a lot of things that you may not even recognize. You know, it's something that they're continuing to research, and I'll keep an eye on that research as they do it. Did you want to add any of your
opinion? I was drinking diet soda, and I had a friend who drank a lot of diet soda, and she was having a lot of trouble with her joints, and I told her research that we had seen, and she quit drinking her diet soda, and it just changed everything for her.
Okay. She stopped
the
beginning of aspartame.
Yeah. So, I look at stuff, and it isn't a lot of stuff, and I know why.
Yeah. So what are some of the things you kind of know? It's the yogurts.
And
they can do ice creams, anything that says pretty much no sugar added, they put in the aspartame, right? So
if you're trying to do a calorie count and keep track, how accurate are some of these portions? I mean, if you're looking at portions, how accurate are these calorie counts that you see on different packages?
I can't speak specifically to accuracy, but I think the key is portion size. You know, you get a single serving Gatorade bottle, you think it's one serving, but if you look at the label, it's 2.5 servings. So you have to multiply out everything on that label by 2.5. So I think that's the biggest thing to look at. If you are counting calories, make sure that you know what the serving size is. Like an Oreo, when I go to the school, I say, okay, how many Oreos would you eat out of this package? You know, they say 5 or 10, when the serving is really like 2 Oreos, or a bag of chips, 15 is the serving size when Boobies 15 chips. Yeah. So I think that's what you need to look at.
So what the manufacturers are going, you can pretty well depend on. They say 2 items is a portion, and that's going to have this calorie count in it, whether it's crackers or cookies or whatever. You can pretty well depend on that being accurate.
I feel like it's fairly well regulated as far as everything I've seen. That there, I don't have any questions about the accuracy of this label.
That's a big
break.
They had a state fair, and when the teachers are having a deep fried Oreo.
Cool. I was going to be here and have deep fried butter. They had deep fried bread.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
My husband died from complications of diabetes. Oh, he had his toes amputated, and it was his heart that doing it. But he was a truck driver, and he did not get the proper exercise and diet to light foods, and his health just went down the drain.
That's so sad. Yeah. But you've seen firsthand what these complications can do. Yeah. Very sad.
Motivation.
Yeah, that's right. I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad you're sharing. You probably have told other people, you know, what you've been through, so I think that is key whenever you have a situation like this. And you mentioned your friends with the shingles sharing that story, so we can all be health educators. You can all, you know, share your experiences with each other and help each other.
I asked my doctor how I could get rid of it, and he said, well, you could gain a lot of weight and then lose it and see what happens. We kind of laughed. I'm going to do that.
I'm pre-diabetic, and my doctor told me that basically what happened was up to me. She said, if you eat the way I tell you to, and you exercise at least every other day, as much as you can, she said, but 30 minutes would be good. More is better if you're capable. And lose weight. She said, there's no reason you have to become diabetic if you do the things I tell you to do. And yeah, I'm still overweight, but I've dropped 50 pounds over the last 10 years. And I started out taking 2,000 milligrams of metformin every day. I'm off the medication completely, have been for a year, and my numbers are normal. Like I said, I'm between like 80 and 90, 95 every morning. So, you know, it can be done if it's caught at the pre-diabetic stage. Once you become diabetic, whether you can reverse it or not, I don't know, but the more you exercise, the better you eat, you'll help yourself. Yeah, the doctor simply said balance. She said, if you want a piece of cake, fine, have one piece. But then have a handful of nuts with it, or some cheese, some sort of protein. And she said, have one piece, not three.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And I was overweight, and I dropped 74 pounds.
Wow. That's wonderful.
And I kept it off. And I did it for my husband and for myself, because he wasn't able to do it. It seems like his appetite increased with the diabetes.
Okay.
He was just eating constantly.
And being a truck driver.
So I did it for him and for myself. But I still have diabetes.
Okay. So what works for you? Do you do exercise, change the way you eat, both?
I'm trying to do both. I did the eating was what did it for me.
Yeah.
I had weight portions and eat certain foods. And,
Yeah, weight. That's a big piece. I don't think people can really visualize what 6 ounces of protein looks like.
Every day.
Oh, water, that's a good one too.
Giving yourself motivation, you know, is for like, if you want to see your grandchildren, you want to see your friends, you want to socialize. I look at things that I have just too much sugar in it. Sometimes I'll have just a couple bites because I think this is poison and your body doesn't need it. And do you want to see your grandkids and great grandkids? You know, it's up to you.
Yeah, 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 and different people will be at different places. You know, some people are ready to make the change, some people aren't there yet. It'll take a big event for them to, a lot of times with men, to see that. It'll take a heart attack or somebody else, you know, getting sick for them to make a change. But whatever motivates you, you're right, yeah, you gotta think about that. Because it is a serious disease and it can have long-term implications for sure. Yeah, that's very true, yeah, yeah. And especially in the winter, I know around here, it's harder to walk. We don't have a walking facility in town, and even the high school, that would be the outside track, so it is hard. You have to go to Bowling Green or something like that to walk.
You can get, it's like the pedals on a bicycle, and you can sit it on a tabletop. You can use it with your arms, you can put it on the floor, and use it with your legs. So, you know, it's something you can do sitting down, so even if you don't feel, you know, wonderful, you can still do a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. And if any of you are on YouTube, I know they have lots of videos on YouTube now, too, free, that you can watch different exercises. We do one at work, which is just walking during the lunch period. You might think, oh, you need a video to walk, but it's motivational. I think they play music, you do different speeds, sometimes you sidestep, things like that you can do inside, no matter what the